brighter days. Before the dark ones came, stole my mind, wrapped my soul in chains. Now I live among the dead, fighting voices in my head, hoping someone hears me cry in the night and carries me away.
Go to children's church, please. Third grade and under. You'll enjoy it. 12 in 7th grade. So, yeah. Welcome. Glad you're here. So one thing we really enjoy doing is shaking hands. So why don't you go get up and shake somebody's hand you haven't spoken to. Now. Stand and sing with us.
Go to the mountain, I can't seem to find my way. I'm a survivor.
texting out late. Oh, but I heard a whisper. Has heaven been down? Say, child, don't you know that the first will be last and the last get crowned?
has been new use what you have given us as your hope, spread the word of you dying once again. I just hope you're willing to work in the heart.
My name is Seth. This is Frank.
Hi.
This paper says message. This your paper says message. Then say message. Well, so, there are going to be words today, alright? I want you to figure out what the first letter of each word spells. Tell me what it says, alright? Go ahead and type. Now it says Eustace. Alright. So, unconditional love of God. God loves you no matter what. You see, if God didn't love you, would you have sent his son die for you? So, in 1 John 4:16, it says, so we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is the love of whoever abides in him. Whoever in love abides in God, and God abides in him. No, God absolutely hates sin, but he loves us sinners. This leads us into sin.
For the desires of the flesh are against the spirit, and the desires of the spirit are against the flesh, for these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. Galatians 5:17. Sin is temptation, such as lust for a woman, or getting addicted to drugs or alcohol. Sin is flesh, even though God blesses us with things we choose to be selfish and not share what we are given, and on top of that, we are greedy and want more. Sin is a world we envy people who have what we want. For instance, Seth might even envy me because I like my guitar.
No, Frank might envy me because I have a car.
Sin is Satan. Satan will tell you it's okay to lie about stealing from your mom to go to the football game. Then after you do, he'll make you feel guilty about telling that you're an awful person.
Well, you see, no matter what, you could be an awful person, but because of Jesus, if you're an awful person, you still go to heaven. So, Jesus, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Son of God, Lamb of God, Christ, Bread of Life, Prince of Peace, Messiah. Amen.
Amen.
Let's sing a song. I want you to join me. All right. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. It's awesome. Now, do I have any current Olympians in here? Saw that, Mason. Saw that. So, when I was an Olympian, we had a verse, John 3:16. So I'm going to go around searching. Is there an Olympian who can tell me that verse? Anybody? Anybody? Maybe you, Eli? Maybe. Maybe. Maybe Josiah or Charlie? So I said, no. Maybe an Olympian leader. Oh, Rylan and Colby, I didn't see you guys. Hey, can you guys tell me that verse?
For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. So, whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life.
The Olympians are awesome. I was an Olympian until I was in 7th grade, and that was awesome. Now I'm an East. Alright, let me see. In Romans 10:9-10, it says, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one's believed and is justified, with the mouth one confesses and is saved. So, is saved, which leads us to salvation.
Brett led me to salvation when I first came to Mass back last year, November 3. I spoke to Brett when at his trunk about rebirth. I ended up getting a ticket and went to rebirth, and that's where he led me to salvation. He led me to rebirth and they led me to Christ. That's how I was able to accept Christ into my heart. You can't be saved by doing good deeds. You need to remember that. A lot of people think that they can be saved by doing good deeds, but really,
can't do it. Yeah.
There's only one way to be saved, and that's through Jesus Christ. That died so that we can go to heaven. The best part of salvation is that you're God. Yeah. That you're Bob. Yeah.
And God stands for eternity. So, you know, everyone is like, oh yeah, eternal life. But there's actually two types of eternity. Did you know that? See, I'm going to know. I'm pretty sure you all know that. So, eternal life is in heaven, but eternal death is in hell. So, the moment you accept Jesus into your heart, the moment you're granted eternal life, and eternal death is earned by never accepting God into your heart. In John 5:24, it says, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life. So, me and Frank have eternal life. Who else has eternal life? I'm pretty sure you two do. Pretty sure you do. Oh gosh, I'm pretty sure everybody does. So, it's not up to me. Do you want to make that decision? I can't make it for you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Frank and Seth, for sharing with us. And what they talked about today was they actually shared with you about the person who is at the center of all of history. And it took courage and boldness for them to stand up here and share that with you. And so I'm very proud of them for being able to explain to you the gospel and the gospel message, that is that Jesus came and died for you. He wants to have a relationship. And so it took courage and boldness for them to do that. And so these two young men just shared with you about the central figure of all of history. And so I'm going to just wrap this up here just a little bit. We'll probably be done early today than what most of us are used to. Don't hold Scott to the same standard when he is back. But if we were to take a panoramic view of the Bible today, we would see that Christ's death, his burial, and his resurrection is central to everything. The Creator revealed himself. The Creator allowed himself to be sacrificed, and the Creator is coming back as a judge. So the greatest truth, I believe, the greatest truths in the Bible are the simplest ones. Okay? And the simplest way the Bible presents itself would be this way. That all of the Bible, right up to about John chapter 19, which is most of this right here, is all about the Creator being ignored. The Creator of the world being ignored and rejected. That's what we see from Genesis chapter 1 to about John 19. We see that to John chapter 19 that the Creator is ignored and rejected. And all the stories of the prophets, the plagues, centered on the Creator who allows himself to be revealed, is ignored by most people and rejected by almost everyone, and very few ever listen to him. And then from John chapter 20 to Acts chapter 1, it's really only about two or three pages in your Bible. It talks about the crucified Savior who's risen. It's such a small piece, but it, but it's the central event of everything. And everything from the beginning and the end all point to that one particular point in time. That one event in both directions. And then from Acts 2 to the end is the message of the apostles who said that the creator of the universe, who you've ignored and rejected, came as a human. He was killed for your sins. Your sins crucified him, and he's risen, and he's the Savior who stands with his arms stretched out to you right now towards every single person. And if you would just reach out to him, he's never more than an arm's length away. And so the ignored Creator became the crucified Savior, who is risen, and now he's standing just arm's length away. And however, that's not the end of their message. They didn't say, well, isn't that nice? No, they ended it by saying, if you don't respond and reach out to him, he's that angry judge who is coming again with a fiery wrath, and you will eternally suffer. So let's look at the first part of this book. Most people, from Genesis chapter 1 to John chapter 19, the majority of the story that you see in there is that this, that most people God asked to represent him had other plans. Something more important to do than what God wanted them to do. And God told them how he wanted them to conduct their lives, their family, their business, and everything about them and what their focus should be on. And they said, no, I got other plans. Thanks for yours, but mine are better. Can you imagine that anyone would think that their plans, activities, or hobbies would be better than the plans that the Creator has for them? But you know, the most frequently confessed sin in the church today is that I just don't have time to spend with them. Not much has really changed, has it? People still think that their plans are better than God's. I mean, who wants to read his plan anyway when I have so much other stuff I need to do? The Creator was known only by a few, ignored by many, and rejected by most. And that's the bulk of what we see in the Old Testament. And so the Creator comes to earth himself in the New Testament. Few know or even following or obeying God. And he comes to earth as a human himself. And his life is recorded in a series of scenes of people either ignoring him or rejecting him. And with just a few scenes of people actually worshiping, adoring, and believing in him. But most don't. I mean, they saw and experienced supernatural feedings, miraculous healings, demons proclaiming that he was the Son of God, that he was God. But the people were still yawning. And so the Gospels of the New Testament end with the Creator being ignored, rejected, and murdered. And the second part of this panoramic picture is this, that the Creator, ignored and rejected by most, back to life. And he showed himself, but only to those people who had believing eyes. Jesus wasn't seen or touched by anyone except those who had believed in him. And he spent 40 days with them, and he taught them, and he reassured them of his plan. And then the crucified Creator became the risen Savior, goes back to where he came from. And so Jesus goes back to heaven, and as he's on his way back, he leaves blessings to those who believe in him. And he says, I bless you with this gift of the gospel. Now go and share it. And share the good news. But that brings us to this third part of the Bible, the end. From Acts chapter 2 to the end of the book. And that is this, that the angry judge is returning. You can't find any presentation of the gospel in the New Testament without a warning nearby. And that warning is this: the Creator, who is the Savior, will be the judge. And Acts 17:31 says this. It says, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given us assurance to all by raising him from the dead. What that means is this: that one day Jesus will come back as judge. And we have proof of that because God raised him from the dead. We can have assurance of that because God raised him from the dead. So Jesus is judge. And right now he's standing with his arms wide open, waiting for you to respond and reach out to him. But if you don't, he's going to be your judge. So listen, you've ignored and rejected your Creator. He's been crucified because of your sins. He's risen and he has his arms out to you right now. So what does he want you to do? He wants you to repent of your sins and turn away from your sins and reach out to him. That's what he wants from you. Why? Because when he comes to judge the world, as we see what's proclaimed in 2 Thessalonians 5, that he is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. And they will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord. So there are two groups of people in this passage, probably here today. People who have never reached out to God, even though they knew that he existed, they've never, and he's standing there with his arms wide open, they've never reached out to him. And then there are those other people who have heard, but they've never truly obeyed. They just want to be card-carrying Christians. See, listen, the gospel changes your life. The gospel changes your life. And if you have a relationship with the Creator, then you will bear fruit that proves that. But if your life hasn't changed, chances are you're probably not really saved. So if you've never reached out for Jesus Christ, now is a great day for that to happen. All you have to do is call out to him and say, you are my Creator. My sins nailed you to the cross, and you died in my place, and I accept that as my payment in my behalf. And if you're a believer and your plans are more important than God's, then this would be a great day to repent and say, God, I'm tired of following my plans. I would rather know you than anything else. So we're going to play this song. The song is called Different. It's a song that most of our youth, your loves, they love hearing this song. Dare to be different. And today, if you want to reach out to God, you say, God, I want to have a relationship with you, I would encourage you during this time, as this song plays, you can just come on forward. You can come talk to me. My microphone won't be on or anything. We can have a private conversation even right up here. And maybe you're here and you say, hey, you know what? I've lived my life and I've been living my life by my own plans. And I've said, God, I don't want your plans. Maybe it's time for you to come on board and repent as well. And ask Jesus to help you follow his plans. So as this song plays, you guys can stand with us. Listen to the words. You know the song. Sing it out. Come now. No one will be more excited for you to come forward than this group of people right here, right now.
Give me a vision.
You don't have to be ashamed or embarrassed.
to be set apart.
Everyone in this church will rejoice.
I recognize the man in the mirror. And I don't want to trade your plan for something familiar. I can't waste your day. I can't stay the same. I want to be different. I want to be changed. Till all of me is gone, and all that remains is a fire so bright, the whole world can see that there's something different. So come and be different in me. And I don't wanna spend my life stuck in a pattern. I don't want to gain this world, but lose what matters. So I'm giving up everything because I want to be different. I want to be changed till all of me is gone. And all that remains is a fire so bright. The whole world can see. There's something different, so come and be different. Oh, I know that I am far from perfect. Through you, the cross still says I'm worth it. Take this beating in my heart and come and finish what you started. Oh, you can see me blessed and seen.
Morning. You guys can go ahead and have a seat, and we're gonna wrap up our service here now. But I want to go through if there's any announcements here that we need to go over. Our pastor is still gone for a couple weeks, and so if you need anything, if you need assistance with anything, Brother Mike is going to be our deacon on call. So there's his phone number right there. He can reach out to anyone else that you need as well. Don't forget our trunk or treat is coming up October 30th. Okay, from 6 to 8, we're going to be giving away some gift cards for the best trunk, the best chili. We're going to have a cakewalk and different games and things of that nature. So if you have not yet, there is still a sign up in the back. Feel free to sign up either to decorate the trunk or work on the games or anything else that needs to go on there. Our next announcement is November 6th. We actually have an Olympian fast car. That's on a Wednesday night at 6:30. And so all of you who normally come on Wednesday night, adult Olympians, bring your fastest Hot Wheels car, and we're going to race it out the track, and we'll see if we can walk away with bragging rights, all right? I know that none of y'all are going to beat me, so here we go. The next announcement is there is hope for the hungry, okay? October 22nd, which is Tuesday. All right, so Tuesday we have Hope for the Hungry. If you are available to come and help and serve in that ministry, we'd love for your help to be able to come to help load groceries and things like that into people's cars, come and pray with them. Probably we need some help in that area of counseling and things of that nature as well. So please come and join us for Hope for the Hungry. October 30th, which is the same day as our trunk or treat, is the final day to get in and buy your ticket for Reverb at the price of $43. Okay, after that price jumps up. Okay, Reverb is November 22nd, and so we want to make sure that we get the locations that we want and all that kind of stuff. So we need a commitment from you of some funds. Okay, you can give the money to Jenny when you get that. The next thing is Saturday, October, sorry, November 9th is our Serve to Live, Live to Serve weekend. So we're going to go on November 9th and go do service projects with throughout the community. There's a sign-up board right there back near the sound booth. And so no one for the groups has to have a meeting today for any reason, didn't they? We're all good with that. Everyone knows what they're doing. We're all squared away. Okay, I know they've done that last few weeks. So if you have not signed up, please go do that as well. Ladies retreat, the $40 deposit is due, is past due. Okay, so they accepted it today. If you want to come see Angela and give her the money for that, that would be great. I'm not going to say anything else about that. So, Chicks and Chatter Ladies Gathering. Man, y'all are getting together a lot, aren't you? All right, that's Monday, November 4th, from 6 to 8 here at the church. It says, need nothing except your smile. All right? And then there's a lot of announcements, too. The North Georgia Murray County Night of Inspiration. This is what we used to have. You guys remember M Night, Missions Night that we used to go to Salem for. We're actually going to all go to Holly Creek Baptist over in Chatsworth, and it's a family event. And so I think that they're going to have things like inflatables for kids. Hopefully, I'm not promising too much. Things for the kids to do as well. But there's going to be a special speaker for us adults and a special worship pastor coming to come and lead us in that as well. So it's a family event, so please come and join us for that. All right. We love you guys. Thank you for coming. We do have youth group tonight at 5, so make sure that you are aware of that. But we love you all. You are free to go. Thank you.